art light.
Thank you.
Good morning. December 6, 2020. The sermon this morning is about new love and how we wait and anticipate new love during the Advent season. So let's begin with the words of Jesus about love from the Gospel of John, chapter 15, verses 9 through 17. As the Father loved me, I too have loved you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy will be in you and your joy will be complete. This is my commandment. Love each other, just as I have loved you. In verse 13, no greater love. No one has greater love than to give up one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I don't call you servants any longer because servants don't know what their master is doing. Instead, I call you friends because everything I heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You didn't choose me, but I chose you. And appointed you so that you could go and produce fruit, and so that your fruit could last. As a result, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. I give you these commandments so that you can love each other. And I want to put together with Jesus' words, the words of the Apostle Paul, St. Paul, to the Corinthians in the first letter, chapter 13. And he says this to them, if I speak in tongues of human beings and of angels, but I don't have love, I'm a clanging gong or a clashing cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy, and I know all the mysteries and everything else, and if I have such complete faith that I can move mountains, but I don't have love, I'm nothing. If I give away everything that I have and hand over my very body to feel good about what I've done, but I don't have love, I receive no benefit whatsoever. Love is patient. Love is kind. It isn't jealous. It doesn't brag. It isn't arrogant. It isn't rude. It doesn't seek its own advantage. It isn't irritable. It doesn't keep a record of complaints. It isn't happy with injustice, but it is happy with the truth. Love puts up with all things, trusts in all things, hopes for all things, endures all things. Love never fails. As for prophecies, they will be brought to an end. As for tongues, they will stop. As for knowledge, will be brought to an end. We know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, what is partial will be brought to an end. When I was a child, I used to speak like a child, reason like a child, think like a child. But now that I have become a man, I've put an end to childish things. Now we see a reflection in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know partially, but then I will know completely. In the same way, that I have been completely known. Now, faith, hope, and love remain these three things. And the greatest of these is love. Jesus' teachings on love and Paul's teachings on love. You know, some say love is a river that drowns the tender reed. Some say love is a razor that leaves your soul to bleed. I can barely keep a straight face. Some say love is a hunger, an endless aching need. I say love is a flower and you're its only seed. I'm just kidding. That song got Bette Midler a Grammy. And it's some of the ways we think and feel as a culture about love. There's also love stinks. There's being lucky in love or falling in love and wasting your love. There's everlasting love and endless love. And the Beatles said, all you need is love. But when I say love, what does it mean to you? Is it similar to these sentiments and songs like The Rose by Bette Midler? Or does it mean something greater, as in the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians? In our modern culture, we reserve love for weddings and babies and Valentine's Day. And in his book, Love is the Way, Bishop Michael Curry does an excellent exegesis of Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, as only he can, by starting out talking about how this passage, this 13th chapter, is often used in weddings. And of course, he being the featured American preacher at the most recent of the royal weddings in the United Kingdom of Prince Harry and Meghan Markle. So he knows something about what he speaks. And he says this, love the sentiment becomes love the sedative. It's a good feeling that rises up inside you and it points to the sweetness of life. And it's passive. And actually, for some, this feeling, this sentiment is quite rare because of loneliness. But the love that Paul is talking about here has nothing to do with weddings and Valentine's Day and sentiments. As he's trying to lead this group of Jesus followers, this community in the way of Jesus, he has to define what love is because Jesus made such an emphasis of love. You see that in John's gospel. And because these people trying to follow Jesus have lost their way. You could easily see how they've lost their way just from taking the passage and looking, examining what Paul is playing defense against. These Corinthians were tearing each other apart. Sound familiar? They were being impatient and unkind. They were being jealous and arrogant and rude braggarts who apparently were continually seeking their own advantage and with irritability were keeping a record of complaints. These Corinthians were perpetrating injustice and untruths. So, Paul has to come at them, playing defense for love. This is not what love is. Love is this. Love, in the context of people who want to follow Jesus and keep his commandments, is an action word. It's a choice that can turn the world upside down. It's not a sentiment. This way of love is not easy. And Paul makes evident how important love is, how essential. But for us, we need to pay attention to this message today because we are living in Corinth. We are forever tearing each other apart. You can look at this passage and you can see how they were acting towards one another. You could see it happening on social media or in person with people who used to be friends or used to speak to each other at family gatherings, with our anonymous complaints all the times, with trolls on the internet, with our closed off attitudes. We do it in the political sphere, we do it in the public sphere, and even in the church. Most appropriately for the passage today, he's trying to build this faith community, and there's so much infighting. If we leave love over here, some sweet, sappy sentiment that, you know, we experience sometimes, then we're never called to a higher standard. We're never called to, in the words of Bishop Curry, stay decent in indecent times. The way of Jesus' love will cost us something. And that's why Jesus says it's a commandment in John's gospel. We remain in Jesus' love when we act with love as he did. And he points it out. No one has greater love than to give up one's life for one's friends. This kind of love will cost us something. The opposite of love isn't hate. It's selfishness. The way of love puts the we in front of the me. It's easy to do and yet extremely hard when you think about, are you being selfish or are you being loving? Are you including just your own interests or the interests of others? And in the words of, again, Bishop Curry, where selfishness excludes, love makes room and includes. Where selfishness puts down, love lifts up. Where selfishness hurts and harms, love helps and heals. Where selfishness enslaves, love sets free and liberates. Maybe this kind of love, our way of doing love, is new to you. Maybe this whole idea of what Paul's chapter meant, or what even Jesus was talking about when he was with his disciples, is new to you. Maybe the idea that love isn't this sentiment on a pink doily at Valentine's Day is new to you. But perhaps we all need a refresher on Jesus' commandments. This new love is the way, and it's not easy. So that when we sing Love Came Down at Christmas, we're not talking about Karen Carpenter singing Merry Christmas, Darling. We're talking about this new way of love, this radical, earth-altering, self-sacrificing love, Jesus' love. And when Jesus is talking to them about how important love is, he goes away from it, he talks about fruit a little bit, and then he returns to his earlier point, emphasizing the importance of love again when he says, and I almost hear the urgency in his voice, I give you these commandments so that you can love each other. I give you these commandments so that you can love each other. Love each other. Amen.
That tells us Christmas time is here. See the stars tonight. They're shining bright, 'cause it's Christmas time. And it's my favorite time of year. Deck the halls with boughs of holly. Give me mistletoe. It's a season to be jolly. Wrapping presents, writing cards, helping decorate the tree. But there's one thing that makes it all for me. When carol singers gather round, angel voices fill the town. It's like the world is joining in. They sing a merry song, and we all sing along. A festive melody that tells us Christmas time is here. See the stars tonight, they're shining bright, 'cause it's Christmas time, and it's my favorite time of year. Christmas Eve, still believe, so excited, can't sleep. When the morning comes, church bells ring.
This year, Christmas is going to be different. We won't be gathering in Fellowship Hall on Christmas Day for a shared meal. Many of us are looking for a way to make Christmas better for someone else, because we know Jesus didn't ask to be let into people's hearts. He called them to follow Him. And following Jesus is a call to relational and social activities, and it involves justice. So I have some suggestions that you might do this Christmas to make things better for someone else. Call someone who is isolating because they are at high risk for COVID-19. Send cards to people in assisted living and long-term care facilities or prison. Do something special for a neighbor experiencing a difficult time. Have a meal delivered to someone who is alone. Share food with someone who is in need. Give to the Good Samaritan Fund and help families at Christmas to pay the rent, utility bills, put food on the table, and buy presents for their children. Just make your check to Ocean View and put Good Samaritan Fund in the memo and send it to the church or drop it in the offering plate. Merry Christmas.